Will you join me in prayer? Gracious and loving God, be with the meditations of our hearts and the words of my mouth. We ask this in your good and strong name. Amen. I don't know if you had the opportunity to see Wednesday's Oklahoman in the newspaper. There was an ad in the newspaper that talked about 42 houses of worship that participated in an ad. And the ad read, "Are Christian, Jewish, Muslim, Buddhist, Sikh, Unitarian Universalist, and Hindu houses of worship. Support peace, hashtag peace for Oklahoma. On March 3rd through the 5th, we will devote our worship services to a message of tolerance and respect for all peace-seeking people. Please join us in working towards peace for Oklahoma." I'm proud to say that Southern Hills Christian Church is part of this initiative. This weekend, in addition to hearing the message of peace preached in different houses of worship, people are taking to social media. They are sharing their own message of hashtag peace for Oklahoma. They are taking selfies and posing with written messages with this hashtag. For those of you who don't know what hashtag means, on social media, there is the hashtag symbol and then a short little phrase that goes afterward. And if you click on it, you can see all the things that people have said about that on Facebook and Twitter. And so the hashtag for this is hashtag peace, the number 4, okay. So this is going to be back in the gathering area. If you would like to add your message of peace, there's some chalk back there, and you can write a message, and someone can take a picture, and we can post it to our Southern Hills Facebook page and share our message of peace for Oklahoma. But people all around will be taking a message of peace for Oklahoma. They are boldly proclaiming how they are called to be a people of peace in Oklahoma. They demonstrate how even when we are different, ideologically, theologically, and politically, we can all still come together under a united message of peace and love. There's something powerful about knowing that this morning, that yesterday, that Friday, people were united in hearing a message of peace across different faith traditions. And that then they are joining all across the state at different places to break bread together, to post messages of peace together, an imam and a Christian pastor standing together proclaiming we can work together. There's something powerful when we come together and break bread, when we share a hug and a handshake, and we say together with our voices, we can do this. There's strength when our voices unite together to affect change. As I've been thinking about this, yesterday I had the opportunity to hear Anna Carter Florence, who is a homiletics professor at Columbia Theological Seminary, speak in Norman. And I have to confess to you that her message to us was so profound that I came home and rewrote my whole sermon. It just happens sometimes. And her whole lecture affirmed for me the power of community when they are let loose to practice and live their sacred texts. When people gather to post messages about their sacred texts in a message of peace, there is such power. She challenged those of us gathered to rethink how we each are sharing the word of God. She said that we need to listen to the texts together as we try to find something new. And she reminded us that all texts need to be practiced, and we need to then let ourselves loose with the text. She said that the church is a repertory church, and the scriptures are script from which we build our art form, the living play with which we tell our story of faith. She also talked about it in terms of music. You know, in our world, we like to be solo artists a lot of time, don't we? We like to shine. We like to stand up in front of people, and we love to have the attention brought on us. But the text of our faith is meant to be a beautiful ensemble where we bring our different voices, our different harmonies, and we unite them together to share in a common message. It's something that is done in community. She challenged us to find ways to work together as an ensemble, to say something together that is true about the work of the scriptures. As I've been thinking about this, the truth is when I come up here to preach, I'm completely aware that the word wants to speak through more than just me. The word wants to speak through each of you, through the body of Christ, through our communities united. The word wants to speak through not just Southern Hills, but First Christian Edmond and Trinity and First Baptist and the Nazarene Church across the street and through the Methodist Church across the street. The word wants to speak through all of us communally as we go out and live and practice the text and as we are let loose with it in the community. But the question comes for us, how do we, as Anna Carter Florence said to us yesterday, follow the wild biblical text which leads us to where the wild things are? I loved how she challenged us to do this. She said, really, for me, it was kind of an experience of going back to my dad around a table or my grandmother's conversations or my 12th grade English teacher. Because she said we have to look at our sentences together communally in the text and break it down into grammar. But she cautioned us, when we break it down into grammar, the thing that we really have to face are the verbs. She said we enter the text through the verbs. The adverbs and the nouns, they make it pretty. They tell us a little bit something about the story. And the nouns, that's where we tend to get hung up on. We get hung up on telling the story of what the noun means. And then we start talking about, well, am I really that noun? I don't know if I can be that noun. Well, maybe I just need to not deal with this because I have no relationship to that noun. And so we distance ourselves from it because we weren't living during the time of the text. We can't fully understand the culture and the history because we are in a different time. And so when we hear certain things, it's hard for us to wrap around those nouns. But we all can relate to the verbs. The verbs that say they were sent. I say to you, love. We can do those verbs. We can live those verbs. We can enter into those verbs. And then we can go explore where the wild things are. This morning, the text literally takes us into the wilds. The Message Bible translation says, next, Jesus was taken into the wild by the Spirit for a test. Jesus is taken. He doesn't go himself. He is literally taken into the wilds for a test. I want to invite us to allow ourselves to be taken this morning, to be taken to join Jesus in the desert. When we hear the word next, we know that there must have been something that happened prior to this, right? Next implies something happened, and then next came this. Well, we have to go back into Matthew 3 and read the words just before this. In Matthew 3, we are told that Jesus is baptized by John. The text reads, the moment that Jesus came up out of the baptismal waters, the sky opened up and he saw God's Spirit. It looked like a dove descending and landing on him. And along with the Spirit, a voice, this is my son, my chosen, marked by my love, the delight of my life. Now, what I've always found interesting is it ends with that delight of my life. And then it comes right into, and next, Jesus was taken. There's no other transition. We're not even told Jesus gets up out of the water and gets a towel and dries off. He just goes. He's taken in. It's like a whirlwind picks him up out of the water and flings him into the wilderness. There's no go home and take a nap because it was a big, long moment in the waters and now he's exhausted from the revelation. No, he's just taken up and taken into the wilderness. The voice of God speaks, and the very next action is that Jesus is taken into the wilderness for a test. But before the test or temptation, Jesus does something. He fasts for 40 days and 40 nights. Fasting for 40 days and 40 nights should ring a memory bell for each of us. Do you remember the story that we heard as children? The story that we sing the song of? Arky, arky. It's gonna floody, floody, all of that. Noah and the great flood. Rain fell on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights. And then there's Moses, who went alone to Mount Sinai, and as he wrote the Ten Commandments for, you guessed it, 40 days and 40 nights. Elijah, yep. He also fasted for 40 days and 40 nights as he fled to Mount Horeb, where he was encountered God. The number 40 is also woven into the sacred story of Exodus. 40 days and 40 nights is all over. So when we hear that, we hear Jesus' story going back to all of those people who sat and listened and waited for a revelation from God to be encountered by God. There's something about this fasting for 40 days and 40 nights in solitude. It's repetitive over and over in the Bible. While Jesus is fasting in the wilderness, he wrestles with faithful practice as the tempter comes to tempt him. The test brought to Jesus by the tempter is three questions that ultimately are variations on the same theme. He tempts Jesus to go for power so that he might ultimately be like God. First, he tempts Jesus to claim power to do the miraculous, turning stones into bread. The second temptation is for Jesus to show his hero card by going up to the highest of places and flinging himself down so that angels might come and catch him so that he might not even hurt his pinky toe. Show how he can be a hero, because we all love a good hero and nothing gets us behind somebody better than a hero, right? I mean, we have adults who wear Superman shirts still. I'm not lying. I've got a Supergirl shirt. We love a good hero. And then the last temptation explicitly tempts Jesus to make a power play by worshiping the tempter. And in return, he will receive all that his heart desires, all the kingdoms of the world, all of the riches, just for worshiping the tempter. The truth is, we all know the promise of power is a great temptator for all of us. It's a great tempter for all of us. We know this individually, corporately, and institutionally. We don't have to look far to see what the quest for power can do to any of us. Sure, we might not have ever been faced with having been shoved out a window at Chesapeake at the Vast restaurant. We can't really know what that might feel like. Nor have literally any of us had the whole world handed to us on a platter for us to control and manipulate like Pinky in the Brain. But there are some of us, maybe, who have felt the gnawing pangs of hunger. Or maybe we've heard the cries of a starving baby. And in those situations, it's easier to think about how we might respond if someone came along with this crazy ability to just turn food into a stone into food. When a crying baby who's hungry is screaming out loud, and someone says to you, here, You have the ability to turn this stone into bread. We can't help but look at that crying baby and think, there might be something to this, right? I mean, children go to school every day and eat paper just to fill their tummies to get through the day. And all around the world, people risk the loss of a hand or long imprisonment for just a loaf of bread. The temptation is real. Temptation comes to us in so many forms. We turn on the TV and we're told, if we want to be happy, Derry talked about this, we're told to buy more and more stuff. We're not told that happiness, as Derry told us, is found in community, coming to church and caring for each other. We're told, just buy another iPhone, another pair of jeans, just buy this hair product so that you can have a thick, lush head of hair and your life will be happy. That's temptation. Temptation comes when we look at the color of someone's skin and listen to their accent and watch how they pray and watch what holy book they pick up and allow these quick judgments to shape how we will treat the person. Temptation comes when we close our eyes to the face of poverty, hunger, and disease. Temptation happens when we see the people standing on the street corner that says, not a hand out, but a hand up, holding and requesting just a $2 donation for a magazine called The Curbside Chronicle, and we turn our eye. Temptation comes in many different forms. Temptation allows our fears and anxieties and anger and the need to control, define who we are. Temptation gives us the ability to justify laughing at a racist, sexist joke or at a joke that dehumanizes somebody and then turn around and say, well, we really didn't mean it. We just found it to be funny. Marietta Ansuetz writes, temptation wins when we get caught up in the trappings of life that we lose sight of life itself. These are the faceless moments of evil that, while they seem mundane, lurk in the recesses of our lives and our souls. The truth is, we've entered into these 40 days of Lent, and it's a perfect time for us to engage in those dark places, for us to come face to face with the ugly, to name the temptations that we face daily out loud, and to confess that we need help. We need help, and we need help seeking forgiveness for those temptations. Lent gives us days, 40 days, to cleanse the soul for new life beginnings while letting go of all of those things that control us in our fears and our insecurities. Sometimes I wish we could be like kids when it comes to Lent. On Wednesday, as I was sitting helping check in the kids, two of our youth came running in. They said, Jenny, do you know what today is? Well, what is it? What do you think's going on today? It's Lent. What are you giving up for Lent? I have never seen anyone so excited to come in and say, I'm going to give up my electronics. You know who you are. And the other said, I think I'm going to give up sweets. I'm hoping they have that energy this morning, as they've given up those things. We could learn something from kids who are excited to delve and live with the text and live it out loud in the world, to live it passionately, to be let wild and loose with it and proclaim the message of the text. As I think about this, I think that Jesus this morning gives us a clue how we might begin our soul cleansing during this Lent. Each time that Jesus was tempted, he fell back on the story of his faith. Did you catch it? For each temptation he was offered, he refuted it with scripture. His response to the first temptation to turn stones to bread sets the stage for his future responses. Jesus answers by quoting Deuteronomy. It takes more than bread just to stay alive. It takes a steady stream of words from God's mouth. And through the rest of the temptation, he lets the steady stream of chanting of God's words flow through his mouth. He lets wild and loose with the scripture, and he practices it. Jesus continues to that steady stream over and over, saying, again from Deuteronomy, don't dare test your Lord, your God. And then with the last temptation test, he responds from Deuteronomy once more, worship the Lord your God and only God. Serve God with absolute single-heartedness. When I read the responses from Jesus, I'm reminded of the social media gesture known as a retweet. A retweet is simply a reposting or forwarding of a message from another user. Jesus is steeped in the scripture. The one story that we have of Jesus as a boy beyond his birth narrative is that of Jesus as a 12-year-old who's in the synagogue. And somehow he's left by his parents who have gone on to travel back home. And after 3 days, they look back and they realize Jesus is missing. So they, in a panic, go looking for him and they find him. After 3 days, still sitting at the feet of the teachers, listening and asking questions about the text. He was steeped in the text. It lived and breathed through him. You see, Jesus didn't just study the word of God. He practiced it. He let loose with it. He lived and breathed it. So much so that when it came to a hard time in his life, in the middle of temptation, his first response is to use the words of hope that kept him from falling into the temptations. I wonder this morning, when we are met with temptations, what faithful response might look like from us when temptations befall us. What word needs to be spoken through the body of Christ? What needs to be retweeted in God's message today in the world? In a world where it's tempting to close our doors and isolate ourselves into groups that look like us, think like us, and vote like us, what would God call us to retweet in God's message in the face of hate, bigotry, and racism? What one lie would you retreat from the story of faith to those facing real fear and anxiety and threat on their way to living and worshiping and in life? What would you retweet to the many Jewish communities that have experienced bomb threats and graves being graffitied with swastikas and headstones being turned over? What message of the sacred text would you face that hate and bigotry with? What would you retweet to the world? When people are gripped in temptation to look away and keep silent, what words need to be retweeted? I kept asking myself this past Thursday that question. You see, Amber and I went to volunteer at the Muslim Day at the Capitol. There were two messages that kept coming to my mind as the protesters behind us hurled the most vile words in the name of God and Jesus. As protesters called out for violent deaths of Muslims, I kept reciting and retweeting to myself because we were told not to engage or even say a single word and acknowledge the presence of the violent protesters. When a foreigner resides among you in your land, do not mistreat them. The foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. Love them as yourself, for you were foreigners in Egypt. That was the message that I was retweeting from Leviticus. And the other that I was retweeting from Galatians. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. So my day, in that day, when I couldn't engage with the protesters who were saying these violent things, my retweet, as I said these words over and over to myself, my retweet of the kingdom work was done with a simple smile and words of welcome for my brothers in the Muslim tradition, for my sisters in the Muslim tradition. And I want to share with you one of those moments of love, of promise, of peace, of peace for Oklahoma, in a moment shared between strangers who became neighbors. Amber and I, when we got there, were invited to stand across the street And up by the Capitol, there was what they called a corridor of love. And it was a line of people who had signs that said, "We love you. Welcome." And they chanted and they sang, "This little light of mine, we shall overcome," over the chants of hate, of people saying, "God is going to kill you." They chanted those words over them. And Amber and I, with others, were invited to greet our Muslim brothers and sisters who were walking up from the parking lot and stand and flank them on either side and direct them away from the people who were shouting hate, to protect them as a literal barrier between the words of hate, talking to them, distracting them from that. And the first woman I got to walk up with, Amber, she was a young woman, looked like a teenager. And we were walking, and as we got closer to the line and the words of the protesters became louder and the words of love became even more louder, she reached out and she touched my arm. And she had this big smile and she said, "You'll never know how much this means. Thank you." And then she put her arm around me and she pulled me into her side. And she had me walk with her down the line. I couldn't stop from crying. It was a sacred moment. That's how we retreat the message of God. That's how we retreat peace for Oklahoma. That's how we retreat hashtag God says love. How will you retweet this week? What message will you say? Hashtag peace for Oklahoma. Hashtag kingdom living. I hope you'll share it. But more importantly, I hope you'll live it. May you be set wild with the text. Amen.